morning, church. We are so glad you're here and have chosen to worship with us this morning. We'll start this morning with a reading from God's Word. Would you stand with me as we read from God's Word this morning? Sure, I'll stand a little closer. Is that better? Sure thing. Okay, we're reading from Psalm 18, verse 26 through 29. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he made his light to shine upon us. Bind the festal sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. I will give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
As Jesus rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, the people sang, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna in the highest. Let's sing together number 296, Hosanna. Don't sit.
Backside, yeah. Happy Palm Sunday, Torrance First Baptist. Do you think they said it loud enough? You think they did? Oh, okay. Happy Palm Sunday, Torrance First Baptist. I have a couple of announcements for you before we go into this awesome time of Cantata Inc. The first announcement is congratulations to my alma mater, San Diego State, for making it to the national championship. Oh, sorry, it said Sunday announcements, not sports announcements. Okay, my bad. So we are in this Easter season, and here are some announcements I have for you. First of all, we have Peepapalooza for the kids this Wednesday. Kids, are y'all excited about Peepapalooza? We need some more energy, some more coffee, more sugar maybe? But in order to have Peepapalooza be a thing, we need your donated peeps. So please bring peeps to the church and by Wednesday, because that's when we're going to have that activity. The next thing we're going to have is Maundy Thursday. And I'm super excited about that. It's from 6 to 7 on this Thursday. And so we're going to be in the 7. What did I say? On the 6th at 7. There we go. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be meeting in the gym and reflecting on the message that Jesus gave to his disciples in the upper room. So please be there for that. The next thing we have is next week we have Easter Sunday. So I'm super excited about that. So we are going to be celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Also, we're going to be having a few baptisms, so that is super exciting as well. If you have not been baptized before and you'd love to know more about it, please talk to one of us pastors. We want to see as many people baptized on Sunday. In addition, with Easter Sunday happening, we have a bunch of flyers that we would love for you guys to pass out. So they are in the narthex over there. Please just take a few, pass to your neighbors so everyone can know that we're celebrating the resurrection. And they're invited too. Lastly, I am super excited about this. We are going to be serving Torrance High School on Saturday, April 15th. So please be in the parking lot at 8:30. We're going to have our new shirts that we signed up for. And yeah, it's going to be an awesome time as we serve our community. Now, Mr. Randy, can you please come up and lead us as we sing about amazing love?
Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you. I normally don't talk before, but I have something I want to say before we sing, because the choir has been working hard on this cantata. We pray that you would be blessed. The life and ministry of Jesus is characterized by his extraordinary love for others. For 3 years, he taught, healed, served, and preached the good news. And yet, as he approached the end of those 3 years, there was a stark contrast between those who embraced his message and those who were skeptical. Amazing love, this cantata, walks us down the road to the cross as we recount the final hours of our Lord's life, when he was rejected, mocked, beaten, and ultimately crucified by the very people he had come to redeem. Jesus' own words served as a foretelling of what was to come. Greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. The love of God cannot be measured, for it has no end. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an amazing sacrifice, an atoning sacrifice for our sins. This is an amazing kind of love. That is the kind of love, the kind of sacrifice that commands a response. May you find hope in the amazing sacrificial love of Christ. And may it prompt you to fully embrace the claims of Christ, responding with your very best in devotion and service to the one who gave his best for us. So worship with us and be blessed as we sing Amazing Love.
The love of God is truly amazing. It has been demonstrated repeatedly from the beginning of time as the Creator has reached out to share unconditional love with you and me.
This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son to the world that we might live through him. This love that not we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with loving kindness.
I have loved you with an everlasting love, drawn you with my loving kindness. So says our God who reigns on high. So says our God, creator of earth and sky. I have loved you with an everlasting love.
Oh,
The ministry of Jesus was characterized by his extraordinary love for others. For 3 years he taught, he healed, served, and preached the good news. Now, following the miraculous raising of Lazarus from the dead, Jesus, a joyous crowd of followers, prepared to enter Jerusalem in anticipation of the Passover celebration.
The great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Even the shouts of Hosanna still echoed in the air, seeds of doubt were being sown by his critics as they openly questioned the claims of Christ. Amid the contrasting scenes of jubilation and skepticism, Jesus arranged to meet with his closest followers to observe the Passover feast, challenging them to be servants in a world of need as they remembered him in the days to come.
Jesus said, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until I find fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink it again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Thank you.
In these intimate moments and the sharing of the Passover meal, Jesus spoke in sobering tones of what was to come. He spoke of these, his faithful followers who would soon fall away. He spoke of rejection and death, even amid the claims of his disciples that they would never abandon him.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me."
Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will."
Time.
The garden, the solitude of this garden of prayer, was suddenly shattered by the chaos of a large crowd, led by Judas, who had come to arrest Jesus. They took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, who was surrounded by teachers of the law and elders. Numerous false accusations were made during a mock trial, ultimately leading to the decision to hand Jesus over to Pilate, the Roman governor for the region.
Pilate wanted no part of this lynching, saying that he found no bias for the charges. He repeatedly asked Jesus about his claims and the charges being brought against him. Ultimately, though, Pilate relented and handed Jesus over to be crucified.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, also called Golgotha. Here they crucified him and with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle.
Really angry cry.
nailed to a cross to die a criminal's death. Jesus, the living expression of God's incomparable love, took upon himself the hate and sin of the world, rejected, mocked, beaten, and now crucified on a tree of guilt. This sinless servant endured a final round of insults from those he had come to save.
It was now the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man."
A man named Joseph from the town of Arimathea, a member of the Jewish council who had not supported the decision to crucify Jesus, went to Pilate seeking permission to take Jesus' body to prepare and bury it in a tomb he owned. Pilate granted his request.
Pilate also granted a request from the chief priests and the Pharisees that the tomb be made secure until the third day so that the disciples could not come and steal the body, claiming that Jesus had been raised from the dead.
After the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said."
The gracious love of God was demonstrated in the sending of the Messiah, the very Son of God, to live among us. Jesus lived a humble life of love, ultimately sacrificing his life so that we might experience the gift of eternal life. That kind of sacrifice, that kind of amazing love, deserved nothing less than my very best in response. God's gracious gift demands my life, my all.
Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor any else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Oh man, it is, I gotta catch my breath for a hot second. Whew, that's fun. Randy, great job leading the choir. Let's thank Randy. There you are. JJ, thanks for running those slides. You guys could see the words and worship along with us. And Houston and Jim up in the sound booth streaming, everybody. It always takes a lot to put some of this stuff together. You won't want to miss next week either. The children are going to like be part of the praise team, so you're going to want to come for that next week. It's just going to be a great Sunday of worship, As we mentioned already, next week we're going to do baptisms on Easter Sunday. Isn't that awesome? Praise God for that time that we have together. Once again, just thank you, choir. Thank you, narrators. Tom, for stepping in, Julie as well. What an amazing morning we've had to really reflect on this last week of Christ, his Passion Week. We began with the triumphal entry into the city, and we concluded with his triumphal resurrection from the grave. All of that, can you imagine? All of that happened in a week. That's crazy to even think about, to even imagine. Now, last week, if you were with us, Raj finished up the book of Haggai asking if we are offering the one Lord secondary sacrifices or if we're offering him the totality of our lives. We were reminded that God just doesn't desire what we have. What he wants is us, right? He wants all of us. And isn't that a reasonable thing to ask? Because didn't he give us all of him? Absolutely. And this week, we're going to step aside from the minor prophets. We're going to look briefly at that triumphal entry of the king into his city. It is Palm Sunday, after all. Thank you, worship committee, for making sure that we understand that it is Palm Sunday and Easter week with beautiful decorations today. Yeah. Before we dig into God's word, let's take a moment just to ask his blessing. Lord God, we are so thankful. We're thankful so much for you, who you are, and that you so desired to have that relationship with us, that you so loved the world, that you gave your one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Lord, as we look today at your triumphal entry into your city, the city of Jerusalem, the city that at one point seemed to be praising you, but then by the end of that week would turn on you and see you crucified, but yet you wouldn't stay dead, you would rise from the grave. Lord, we ask that you just open our eyes today to a little bit more of who you are. We would understand what it meant for you to sit upon that colt and ride into Jerusalem. We ask this in your name. Amen. Amen. So if you'll open with me your Bibles, if you have them, you can get them from your pews, or if you have your own, open up to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. We're going to be reading through. I'm going to go ahead and just read through the whole account of that triumphal entry before we dig in. It says this, beginning in verse 28 and following. It says, "And when he had said these things, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, 'Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? You shall say this, the Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent away and found it, just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they sat Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road as he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives. The whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" Amazing God, right? An amazing love. And so the king and his disciples are on the road to Jerusalem. Jerusalem, the place where the prophecies of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection will be fulfilled. According to Johnston Cheney, during this final journey, he had ministered in at least 35 different localities, timing the journey just right in order to end up in Jerusalem for the Passover. Now, before they get there, they pass through Bethphage and Bethany. Yes, Beth, you were named after a city. She's looking at me with the side eye. But anyways, Bethany was famous for being the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. What had just happened recently to Lazarus? He was raised from the dead by Jesus. Now, both cities were on that eastern slope of the mount called Olivet, where Jesus would give a discourse about the end of times, or we might refer to it as the Mount of Olives. Now, now that we have this cult, what's the deal with this cult? Before they enter Jerusalem, Jesus sends two of his disciples on an expedition to find a little colt, right? A young male horse or a donkey. Now, we're not told if Jesus has made prior arrangements for this this colt to be, you know, received. We're not told if this is divine foreknowledge on his part. Jesus does mention that it has to be a colt on which no one has ever sat, right? So there's something different about this colt, perhaps implying some sort of purity, maybe making it an animal that was fit for a king. Now, finally, Jesus tells them that if anyone finds this act to be sus or suspicious and questions them, they are to simply tell them this: the Lord needs it. Now, if you're an owner of a colt or a donkey and somebody comes up to you and says, the Lord needs it, how do you respond? Well, I don't know. I might question their credentials, but in this case, there's no questioning whatsoever. Now, why is the colt, however, important? Why is this such a big deal? Well, because it's a prophetic fulfillment of Zechariah 9:9. Okay, I guess I mentioned we weren't doing some minor prophets, but here you go. Here's a minor prophet, right? Zechariah 9:9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And so by riding on this colt, Hughes says Jesus was unequivocally identifying himself with the Messiah. Jesus's identification with the emblem and the specific prophecy was exact. It was a perfect revelation of his position. He is declaring himself to be the Messiah. He is the righteous, and let's not forget, the humble king. And so the disciples find this colt, they untie it, they're questioned by the bystanders, they tell them what Jesus said, and the owners are satisfied, and he gives them back. Now again, why are they satisfied? Because Jesus is indeed Lord. Because he is indeed sovereign over all of the events leading up to his death and his resurrection. Now, if you're those two disciples that are being sent out by the Lord to find this colt, and everything happens exactly as Jesus said it would, how are you feeling at this moment? Aren't you encouraged? Don't you think, man, this is the God who I want to serve. This is my master. This is Jesus the Christ, my Lord. Every detail exactly as he said it would be. And so the disciples then bring this colt back to Jesus. And as they continue upon this road, then it says cloaks are thrown out onto the colt, and so Jesus can sit on it on top of these cloaks, but also onto the ground as the procession makes its way down the Mount of Olives on this road to Jerusalem. Now, is there a significance to these cloaks being put on the donkey or the colt or on the ground? Sounds like a weird thing. Do you just do that, kind of throw your coat in front of somebody so they can walk on it? Maybe back in the, you know, days of chivalry when men would put their coats on so that the ladies could not walk in the mud. You ever see that before? Maybe that's it. I don't know. No, I know what it is. But these cloaks actually do symbolize submission to Jesus as king. It has precedent in the anointing of Jehu as king over Israel in 2 Kings 9, 12, and 13. Jehu as well, the cloaks were spread out before him as he entered into the city. Now, you may notice, however, something missing. What is missing in Luke's account of this, what's going on this event? Hint, look around you. Palm branches. Okay, so what's the deal with that? Well, Luke decides that this is not an important event or you know, thing to mention, but the other gospel writers do. Matthew and Mark mention that they spread branches on the ground, signifying basically the same thing as the cloaks. But now John, however, and so we're going to jump to John for a second, does mention these palm branches. John 12:13 says, so they took branches of palm trees, and they went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." Now, what is the significance of these palm branches? Well, the palm branches were a Jewish national symbol, which was engraved on the coins of the Second Maccabean Revolt. Anybody know that from their history at all? Okay, you might be able to find it in the intertestamental period, the books that are there. But it really was a revolt against the tyranny, and the Maccabeans were the ones who led that revolt, and they came up with this symbol as the symbol of Israel. And that's what that was all about. A national symbol. By incorporating them in their praise, the people then are hailing Jesus once again as the Davidic king, hoping that he is that promised Messiah. And it doesn't stop there, right? They continue on. The procession nears Jerusalem. The disciples, which, by the way, are not just 12. So this is just isn't 12 guys walking on a road with Jesus, you know, making all this noise. This is all of his disciples. So anyone who had come to follow after him, to start believing in his miracles and in his teachings, they're all following him. So it is indeed a great crowd who comes together. It says they began to worship the king, saying, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Now, that first part of that praise is from Psalm 118, verse 26, which Carla opened our service with this morning. It was a prayer of blessing for the coming Messiah. Now, the second part, though, should remind us of another praise that happened way back at the beginning of Jesus' life. Luke 2:14 says, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased." Right? So the angels announced a similar message at his birth, and now his disciples are announcing it as he's entering into the city of Jerusalem. The only difference, Hughes said, the heavenly chorus sing of peace on earth, while the crowd sings of peace in heaven. Now, we know that peace on earth is dependent upon peace in heaven. We have no peace here on earth unless it is sent down from above. It's only then when man finds peace with God that there can be peace on earth. And who offers that peace with God? Who makes it possible? Jesus Christ, right? We know these things. Now, taken all together, you have the cult, you have those cloaks, you have the palm branches, this prophetic declaration. There should be no doubt, right, as to who this man is, who this Jesus is. He doesn't deny their claims. He doesn't silence them as he's done so many times before, saying, "My time has not yet come." In fact, the Pharisees know exactly what's going on, and they tell Jesus to rebuke his disciples. Rebuke them. What are you letting them do? But of course, Jesus doesn't. You see his answer to that, don't you? It doesn't matter if they are silent, because even if they are, the rocks, the stones will cry out. All creation is made to worship this king. Amen? Amen. And once again, we need to ask the question, do they get it? Do the disciples recognize who this is, that he is indeed the Davidic Messiah? He's the king. He enters in on, you know, this steed. But again, what sort of steed is it? It's a colt. It's a baby donkey, right? And so he enters upon this donkey, symbolizing his humility. And by the way, it's borrowed. He doesn't even own it. Well, we actually know he does, because he owns everything. But anyways, Clarence McCartney so beautifully described it like this. He said this: "How strange a contrast to the triumphal entry of ancient warriors and conquerors into the cities which they had taken. This time, no wall was broken down for entry. This time, no garlanded hero standing in his war chariot, driving down the lane of cheering subjects past smoking altars and followed by captive kings and princes in chains. Instead of that, it's a meek and lowly man riding upon the foal of a donkey, riding over cloaks and branches spread on the ground." Now consider that this event happens at the beginning of Passover week, where huge crowds would gather in remembrance of the liberation of the Jews from slavery in Egypt. Are they anticipating the same sort of liberation, the same sort of freedom, if you will? Perhaps they knew the prophecy from Zechariah 9:9, and perhaps they were even in their minds thinking of verse 10, that was about to happen. Verse 10 says, I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Now, their expectation might have been that he would ride in and liberate Israel from the oppression of Rome. But what do they not expect? They do not expect that he will walk this week and then give up his life and die as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. They do not expect that he would defeat the enemy, the evil one, Satan himself. They do not expect that he will defeat the power of sin and death and free them from the wrath of God. They do not expect these things. Because the only way, once again, to bring peace to the nations was for Jesus to die. But once again, he did not stay dead. He rose again on that third day. And so you're going to have to come next week to see the conclusion to this amazing, amazing story. May I also encourage you to come on Thursday as well, to Monday, Thursday service at 7 over in the gym as we reflect on these events, especially on his words that he gave to his disciples in that upper room. Now, at this time, I'm going to ask the ushers to get ready because we're going to have a time of communion. Jeremy and Roger are going to lead us through this, but I want to bless this time as the ushers get ready. Lift us up in prayer. Lord God, once again, we are so thankful that you sent your son Jesus, and Jesus, you walked this life. You lived amongst us. You tabernacled. You dwelt amongst us, and we beheld the glory as of the Father, full of grace and truth. And you sat on this colt and you rode into the city. You were humble, but you fulfilled the prophecy in doing so. And people shouted, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Cried out, Lord, save us. And yet, at the end of that week, you were hanging upon a cross, crying out in agony, my God, why have you forsaken me? And you died. And the earth stood still. And for those next 3 days, it felt like hope was lost as you were buried in a tomb that wasn't even your own. It was borrowed. And yet victoriously you rose on that third day. And now because of that, we can have life in you. We can truly have peace with God. Lord, as we come to the table today, may we be reminded of your great sacrifice for us. We pray this, believing and trusting in Jesus' name. Amen. Ushers, please come forward. Remember, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, if you have placed your trust, your hope in him, this table is for you. Please take the elements, take the bread, the cup. If you want the all-in-one, it's there as well. And then take the tray and pass it on. Just hold on to those for a moment of silent reflection as Cheryl plays.
For us who know Christ as our Savior, this is a very special time. The crowd that welcomed Jesus so many years ago had wonderful cheers, but the cheers turned to jeers, became crucify, crucify. How wonderful it is this morning that we not only welcome the Lord Jesus, but we worship him. God the Son, Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is what communion is all about. Remembering him, remembering his death, and praise God, remembering his resurrection so that you and I might have life. Father God, as we come now to partake of the bread, may we rejoice with all that is within us, that you died for us, you rose again for us, and you're coming again for us. We praise you, Lord Jesus, in your wonderful name. And everyone said, amen. Jesus said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat all of it in remembrance of me.
There's a hymn in my heart that I would just love for us to all sing together, just that first verse. There is a fountain filled with blood. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath their flood. Lose all their guilty stains. The blood of Jesus, there's power in it, and it cleanses us. Despite all of our sin, I think of that second verse about the dying thief who's on the cross next to him. And we, just as vile as he, but all of our sins are washed away because of the blood. May you bow your heads and close your eyes. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for salvation. Thank you, Lord, for there being power in your name, power in the blood. God, because of the blood that flows from your veins, God, we can be here today with hope. Lord, thank you, God, that despite all of our sins that we have done, are currently doing, maybe right now, and sins in the future, God, they are washed away. Lord, it is all because of you. Thank you, Lord, for your work on the cross. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. May we drink this cup in remembrance of him. Randy, may you lead us in one last song.
Let's stand as we sing together this beautiful song, Oh How He Loves You and Me. It's 349 in your hymnals if you'd like to turn.
Jesus to Calvary did go.
Indeed loves us so. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. This is his Passion Week. Let us go forth declaring his praises, singing Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless you guys. Those watching at home, we love you. We hope to see you next week as we celebrate the resurrection together. Bye, guys.